Okay, I don't mean to throw you guys off, but whenever I have the communion service, I like to do the communion service first and then sing, like they did in the actual evening of the Last Supper. So I'd like to ask Samuel and Joseph to please come on up here and help me out with the passing out of the elements. I'm getting used to my new bifocals here. I'm so used to lifting them up, and I don't need to do that anymore, so I need to tilt my head.
They gotta be on the nose.
It takes some training, guys. It's not easy.
You don't have gray hair yet, brother.
Yeah.
It's coming.
That Grecian formula really helps.
He's got kids. He's got gray hair.
Sorry, guys, I have my notes a little mixed up here. Okay. There it is, right there in the middle where it should be, in the middle of all the other notes. Luke? John? Yeah, John chapter 16, verse 28 is where I'll be focusing the devotion here. John chapter 16, verse 28. Please stand with me for the reading of God's word. No, that's should be 32. Yeah. 32 to 33. Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You may be seated. There's three things that the Lord is asking us to remember here. And if you have done a study in the Gospel of John about the event of the Last Supper, you'll see that it starts in John chapter 15, and it's all the way through chapter 18. So with that, he's talking about all these things. He's kind of summarizing everything. And with these things that he has shared with them, or spoken to you, as he put it, he wants you to remember those things. Now, what are those things? He had the promise of the revelation of the Holy Spirit that was supposed to come, where the Holy Spirit would enable them to do the work that was in front of them. Talked about the death and the resurrection and the second advent. He talked about, he left no question concerning his oneness with the Father. He made that very clear in the Gospel of John. He and the Father were one. And then that they would be scattered in a short while, and they would scatter in fear. They would be scattered in fear. He also talked about, he wanted to remember his peace. My peace I give to you. And in that, it was not a false peace. It was not some fairy tale. It was not some just think good things kind of mentality. It was, here's the plan, here's the prophecy that's being fulfilled, and here's the miracles that prove I am the Christ. He gave them a lot to base their belief on, and he proved it. He fulfilled it. And now that it was fulfilled, He was telling him, I'm giving you this to have peace. I am the Christ, you are in me, I am in the Father, we are one. And there's peace in that. Overcome the world. He has overcome the world in every aspect you can imagine. He overcame the world. And he's sharing that with it. I have overcome the world. He said tribulation is going to come. For you Christians, for you that are my disciples, tribulation is coming. And we also have the power to overcome just the world just as he did. We are creatures that are made in the image of Christ. Now, these are the things that he asked us to remember concerning, you know, the words that he had spoken here in this upper room. When we talk about the last, when we talk about the communion service, Paul tells us that you do this to show the Lord's death until he comes. And that truly is, I believe, the primary focus of the Lord's Supper, that we would remember his death and why he died and the power of his death and why he needed to die. These are very important things. These things concerning the death of Jesus Christ bring us into a state of humility that is beyond human ability. You can try and humble yourself. And I think a lot of us do try and humble ourselves. But this God thing, the power of the Holy Spirit, the conviction that comes from the Word of God, the reality that we faced in watching Jesus on the cross and dying, these things drive us to a humility that is exactly where we need to be. Yes, remember these things that he had spoken in the upper room. But the most important thing we need to remember is this thing that brings us to the point that we absolutely need to be in order to be acceptable to God. Repentant, broken, completely humbled by the fact that we are sinners, and it took this. It took the death of God in the flesh to pay for our sins. Let's remember that. All right, please pass out the element of the body, the bread. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verses 14 through 20. No, I'm saving that one for after I'm done.
Oh, gotcha.
Okay. Thank you. Luke 22, 14 through 20. It says, and when the hour has come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks, and he said, take this and divide it amongst yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God come. And he took the bread and gave thanks, and brake it, and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. So City Street Church, actually, Sammy, can you please pray as we partake of the bread?
Heavenly Father, right now we want to thank you and remember this great sacrifice that you made for us, Lord. The blood that was shed, the body that was broken for us. And though, Lord, it may seem unjust, it was just because he took it for us. It should have been placed on our heads, Lord. And we want to thank you for that. We want to thank you that he received every single blow and that he lost every single drop of blood for us. The sacrifice that was made because of his love, Lord. Help us to remember this and help us to spread this news to the rest of the world, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
That this sacrifice was made for us to gain salvation.
City Street Church, let's remember the Lord on his broken body. Okay, can you please pass out the element of the wine? In Mark, chapter 14, verses 23 to 24. The word of God says, and he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily, I say unto you, I will no more of the fruit of the vine drink, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until the day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Joseph, would you pray over the partaking of the element of the blood?
God, thank you for this day that you have given us, for everything you bless us with today. I thank you for the shedding of blood, for that which there is no remission of sins. I thank you for washing all of our sins with the blood of your Son. I pray that we will never forget it. I pray that you would bless this to our bodies, and we do this in remembrance of you. I pray all this in your Son's name. Amen.
Say, sweet church. I invite you to partake of blood. Thank you, guys. You may be seated. So, I know you're thinking, oh, wow, geez, this is kind of a downer. We're supposed to be celebrating Christmas and all excited and the lights. Well, what happened to the lights? But you know what? It all works together. It is the gospel. That God came in the form of a man to live a perfect life so that he could be the perfect sacrifice and understand all the things that we go through and understand all our temptations that we go through, all the pain that we go through. You can't say, well, it'd be easy for you to say because you didn't have to go through what I went through. You can't say that about our Lord. So we're truly grateful. It works all together. And so in this Advent season, let's remember the whole gospel message, starting with the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. Now, I'd like to invite you to take your hymnals. And we're going to turn to number 131. You stand with me and let's sing. What did I pick? Angels from the Realm of Glory. And we will sing the two verses. The first two verses. Amen. 6, the first Noel, we will sing the first and the last.
Where's
today. He just wants to share that he appreciates your love and your prayers for him and his family, and he wants to ask that we would remember to keep his wife in prayer as she's still recovering from the strokes that she had recently. So prayers would be appreciated in that regard. I got to spend a day with him this week, and it's one of my favorite things to do. It really is. He is such a help to me, and such a wonderful example and teacher. So thank you. Appreciate you. Love you. All right. This morning, guys, I'd like to ask again to stand for the reading of God's Word for the message today. Found in Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenus was the governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, unto Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there was in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over the flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, he shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, on earth peace, goodwill towards men. You may be seated. I wanted to read the rest of it. Got a little carried away.
Jose did a wonderful job reading Luke 2, and that's what we'll be looking at this morning. We get close to when we celebrate our Lord's birth, first of the month. I thought it would be a good time to go ahead and preach on the birth of our Lord from Luke's Gospel. So let's go to the Lord in prayer before we begin. Father, thank you for the marvelous grace we have in Jesus Christ as we approach the day where we celebrate his birth, just a few weeks away, Lord. We thank you for the plan of salvation. We thank you that he was born into this world as a man, even though he was God from all eternity. He had to be a man to suffer and die for us. We understand this, Lord. But we thank you for his sinless life and his brutal death for sinners, but also for the glorious resurrection and the hope that we have because of that, Lord. We also want to pray for Marilyn this morning, Lord, as Jerry has asked for prayer for her, for recovery from the stroke, the series of strokes, Lord. And we ask that you would give her great hope and comfort in Christ, but also we pray that you would lay your hand on her physically so that she might fully recover. And we just want to say thank you for being able to come to you with this. And we thank you mostly for Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, Jose's already read the text. I'll be referring to it as we go through this. But a few years ago, I read a Christian help column from a well-known local ministry. A person had written to this ministry saying he didn't feel the joy and good cheer of Christmas and wanted to know how to get into the Christmas spirit. Well, the president of this Christian ministry responded by saying that this attitude during the Christmas season was quite common and that the Christmas season can lose its meaning for many because of sadness, grief, and despair when the world seems so happy and joyous. Well, he went on to say to this man who wrote in, "If your dreams of a white Christmas feel cold and blue, I encourage you to reach out to someone. Spend extra time with family members and get together with a group of friends. It's important to let them know you're going through a rough time and could really use their support." Well, ironically, on this Christian ministry's website, it says that it, quote, provides relevant Christian advice to those who inquire. But I had to ask myself, where was the relevant Christian advice in this president's answer? Why didn't he tell this man to read biblical Christmas accounts and pray that God would work in his heart to grasp the true meaning of Christmas? That Christ came into the world to give us the greatest Christmas gift of all. He came to save sinners. But it was absent. Nothing about it. I mean, if the column didn't have a Christian ministry's name on it, one would think that it came from Dear Abby or some other secular advice. But without question, the Bible does have an answer for people like this despairing man at Christmas. People who are looking for hope this time of year. And Luke 2 will be focusing on verses 8 to 14. In these verses, there is no greater hope. Not just to Christians, but as the text says, to all people. This passage tells us that God has not forgotten mankind. The angels in verse 14 say that God has invaded the world of hopelessness, despairing people, with peace on earth, goodwill toward men. And we'll be looking at what that means this morning as we see in verses 8 through 14, and we need to get this. We see in these verses the angels' first Christmas. And first we want to look at the setting briefly in verses 1 to 7. Shortly after Mary returned home from her visit to her cousin Elizabeth, Luke tells us that, quote, "It came to pass. It came to pass that Caesar Augustus issued a decree that all the world should be registered in the public records of the Roman Empire." And as this unfolds, I want us to just briefly think about four things. Number one, the political context at the time Jesus came into the world. In verses 1 and 2, Caesar Augustus, the ruler of the Roman Empire, appointed Quirinius as a special governor to oversee this census. And number two, the geographical and genealogical context in verses 3 to 5, where Luke shows us that God providentially arranged this census to be taken so Joseph and Mary would be in Bethlehem for the time of her delivery. This is an amazing work of God to bring a tax on all the world so that two people would end up in Bethlehem at the right time. And you remember from the Old Testament prophecies, particularly Micah 5:2, that the Christ had to be born in Bethlehem. I mean, even the religious leaders knew that from Matthew chapter 2 when Herod asked. And they said, Messiah must be born in Bethlehem. Number three, the social context in verses 6 and 7. Shortly after Joseph and Mary arrived in Bethlehem, she reached her term and delivered her firstborn son. And after she wrapped Jesus in long strips of cloth, which was the custom in those days, she laid him in an animal trough for his bed. Joseph and Mary were denied a room in the public inn because no one in the crowded city was willing to give up their room or home for them. But again, this fulfilled Old Testament prophecy, didn't it? Isaiah 53:3 tells us that Jesus would be despised and rejected by men even from his birth. But number four, the spiritual context when Jesus was born. Jesus was born into a world devoid of true religion. The Romans and Greeks worshiped many gods. The Jews worshiped the one true and only God, but in the wrong way. So all three cultures were godless in their own way. Consequently, none of them wanted the kind of Savior God was about to send into the world. So whether Jew or Gentile, the whole world was in spiritual darkness when Jesus was born, as Isaiah 9:2 says it would be. That's why Paul tells us in Galatians 4 that Jesus came in the fullness of time, the perfect time, the darkest time. Sin was everywhere at its height. And although the world would disagree, it really was the fullness of time, the best time for a Savior. But I want us to look more closely now at 8 to 14. I just wanted to set the context before we got into this. So secondly, let's look at the announcement of the angels. The announcement of the angels. Although we do learn the political, geographical, and genealogical, social, and spiritual contexts of Jesus coming in the first seven verses, verses 18 are really what Luke wants to focus on in this account. It's the angels' proclamation to a group of shepherds that a Savior has come into the world. In other words, it's the angels' first Christmas. Just as Jesus, the King of all creation, was born in insignificance when he came into the world, it's no coincidence that the angels' announcement of God's salvation went to the world, which would see the shepherds as insignificant. But these shepherds in Luke 2 were no doubt godly men. We should have no doubt about that. Just like Zechariah and Elizabeth, Mary and Joseph, Simeon and Anna, these shepherds must have been waiting for God's Savior to come into the world. We can be sure that these angels would not have made their announcements to ungodly men or apathetic shepherds. These men, these shepherds, although unimportant to the world, were certainly God's men waiting for God's salvation. And now we see them living in the country, in the fields, just outside of Bethlehem. That's what shepherds did. You remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob lived in tents in the fields. Why? Because they were shepherds. They didn't live in cities, in houses, like we do. These shepherds lived where their work was. And they worked around the clock. No doubt taking shifts every night as he watched over the flocks, guarding and protecting them from dangerous men and ferocious animals that would harm them. But what's really ironic here is that many believe these shepherds were raising sheep for the temple sacrifices at the Passover in just a few months. And if so, these animals would be slaughtered on the altar, and these shepherds were still keeping careful and caring guard over them. Why? Because they knew that they were God's flock for God's sacrifices. Now we're told in verse 9 that before the other angels appeared, one angel of the Lord stood before them. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were greatly afraid. The angel is not identified here, although it could have been Gabriel, the angel that came to Mary in chapter 1. This is an angel sent from the Lord who had a special and specific mission to announce to these shepherds that God's salvation had finally arrived. Then we're told in verse 13 that there appeared with this one angel a multitude, or a great number of angels. How many, we don't know. And if these shepherds were raising sheep for the Passover feast, there had to be a good number of shepherds, enough to watch over 250,000 lambs, a quarter of a million lambs. That was the number that was sacrificed in Jerusalem on Passover. That's an astounding number. So we're not just talking about two or three shepherds here. There were a multitude of angels, but there must have been a multitude of shepherds too. We have multitude of witnesses to this event with the angels. Verse 8 also says that the glory of the Lord shone around these shepherds. This would immediately turn darkness into light for these men. Just as the Shekinah glory and the fire by night brilliantly and blindingly lit the sky for Israel to see their way through the desert. So this glory that the shepherds saw was no doubt lighting the night like nothing they had ever seen before, or any of us have ever seen. We're told in verse 10 that these men were afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid." Well, not only were they afraid, look at the end of verse 9, they were greatly afraid. They were terrified by what they saw. The question that I came up with after reading this: how is it that a company of well-trained, fearless shepherds were so afraid by one angel? I mean, these were rough guys that were tending the sheep. I mean, they would ward off thieves, they'd ward off ferocious animals, and they are greatly afraid of one angel? Well, according to Scripture, this is the response when any mortal man sees an angel. It's great fear. Unlike many today who claim to have seen angels and say they've had a very enjoyable experience with them, every single person in Scripture who ever saw an angel was terrified. I remember listening to one of the TBN shows just when I needed some therapy, I guess. A man talking about how he was shaving one morning and an angel walked in and he was talking to the angel while he was shaving. And just having a good old time with this angel. I asked myself, has this guy ever read a Bible? He was a pastor. Well, whenever someone sees an angel in Scripture, they are greatly afraid. Well, you remember when Gideon saw the angel in Judges 6, says he feared he would immediately die because he saw God's angel face to face. That's how terrified he was. When Samson's father Manoah saw the angel in Judges 13, he too thought that he would die because he saw the face of an angel. When Daniel saw the angel in Daniel 10, he said in verse 8, "No strength remained in me." In verse 11, he stood trembling. When he saw the angel in Daniel 8, he said in verse 17, "I was afraid and fell on my face." When the angel appeared to Joseph in Matthew 1:20, the angel told him what? "Do not be afraid." He was afraid. When the angel appeared to Zechariah in Luke 1:13, he told Zechariah, "Do not be afraid." When Gabriel appeared to Mary in Luke 1:30, he said to her, guess what? "Do not be afraid." So the fear these shepherds had is consistent with fear others in Scripture experienced whenever they saw an angel. But this angel told the shepherds to not be afraid. Why? Well, number one, because they were afraid. But number two, because it was a time for praising God, not fearing Him. For the first time in history, God was bringing good news for all people. First time in history. Not just to one nation or a few people here and there like we see in the Old Testament. Up until now, God had primarily made announcements to His people Israel. But now He had a proclamation for all people, a worldwide Savior, a Savior for all men, Christ the Lord. He says in verse 10, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people." Savior is Christ, the Christ of the Old Testament, the promised Messiah of Israel. And the good news is that He is still the Savior of all mankind today, isn't He?
Thank you.
Nothing's changed. And notice, this announcement to the shepherds came on the same day that Jesus was born. Did you see that? "For there is born to you this day in the city of David." So in less than 24 hours, the angels made the announcement to these shepherds. Jesus had just been born when the shepherds had received this message. The angel intended for the shepherds to immediately go and visit Jesus where He was born, so he told them He was born in the city of David, Bethlehem. He says, verse 11, "For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord, and this will be the sign to you. You'll find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger." You didn't lay babies in mangers in those days. I don't think you ever would want to lay a baby in a manger. That was the sign. In the crowded city, how do you find this kid? Well, you look for a stable with a manger with a baby lying there. In the cool night air, in the cold night air, in an animal feeder, in a stable, wrapped in grave cloths. These are the strips, the same strips that Jesus was laid to rest in the tomb. It's the same term. He took grave clothes and wrapped the baby. What a sign. His birth. How ironic was that? He's just born into the world and he's wrapped in grave clothes. Well, we've already said he's obscure, he's less than welcome. He's born into a different world, or into an indifferent world, and he would be God's Savior to mankind. Well, even though the world did not want him, it desperately needed him, didn't it? If anyone was to see the doors of heaven, Jesus was desperately needed. It's also fitting to see the angel come to the shepherds at night under the expansive skies of Judea, since it perfectly depicts the pitiful condition of the world that Jesus came into. Immense darkness. The light just burst into the darkness of night, indicating the spiritual darkness of the world. Up until this time, there wasn't a greater departure from the living God into indifference, narcissism, immorality, and man-made religion. During this time when Jesus was born, since the flood, it hadn't been this bad. And if the times were spiritually bankrupt and degenerate then, how much more are they now in our own day? Just turn on the news. And Gus and I were talking about it this morning. We're both thinking about getting off of the news junkie habit and maybe just tuning in once a month, because that's about all I can handle anymore. Things are that bad. Conditions have never been worse on this planet.
That's the truth.
Most today are more steeped in their sin than ever before in history and have no interest in a Savior from their sin. Most are in denial of their sin. I was in the restaurant a couple weeks ago with Simon. You all know Simon. We get together once a month before he goes to Bangladesh. And as we were talking, a lady leaned over. She was sitting right behind me. She said, "I heard you talking about prayer and about Christ." And she said, "I don't believe Jesus was supposed to die on a cross." I said, "What?" She says, that was just too horrible. She says, "I can't believe God would ever put his son on a cross like that." And of course, this is typical teaching of a lot of the emergent church. One writer said that God putting his son on the cross was divine child abuse. Boy, if you believe that, you don't have much hope, do you? And of course, we spent quite a bit of time with her, sharing the gospel with her. But she was absolutely set. And basically, I told her if she didn't change her views, she didn't have much to look forward to. Eternal torture in hell, basically. So you might want to pray for her, but most deny their sin. They don't need a Savior. She didn't need a Savior to take away her sins. She didn't think she was that bad. I mean, without the cross, what do you have? Instead, people would rather celebrate their sin and rebel against the God that gives them life and breath. But all of them, every last one of them, needs a Savior. Whether they're going to take him or not is yet to be seen. From eternity past, God had a plan to save men, even though the whole of mankind loved and still does love darkness rather than light. John told us that. Nothing's changed. We all come from the same stock. We're all cut out from the same stump. We come from Adam. All of us need Christ.
Yes.
There's not one worse than the other. Roman and I were talking about that before the service. You know, homosexuality, that's not up here and then all the other sins down here. Sin is sin. One sin is going to damn you.
Black. Yeah.
So I have a question about the gravity. My mom and I were talking about gravity and Christ then, and she made a comment. She says, I believe the only unforgivable sin is killing yourself, because you can't ask for forgiveness and repent after.
And what's the question?
Like the highest on the tier of where sin could be.
You know, there are a lot of believers in Scripture who wanted to kill themselves. Anybody read Jonah?
Well, I explained to her, I'm like,
we're not Catholic, Becca.
Yeah, I was like, I don't see any scriptural basis behind that, so I don't agree with that, but I can see why you think that.
Sadly, there are a lot of Christians that commit suicide. So it's not the unforgivable sin. If you trust Christ and you're a believer, you're forgiven, not past, present, and future. I'm not recommending that for anybody, but, and we all have loved ones or people that we know in that situation, and we need to give them hope. If the person believed in Christ, they're with Him. That's where I'm at with it. So,
I agree.
Amen.
I agree with you.
So, just like today, most people were perfectly content to do without a Savior from sin when He came. The people that Jesus came to minister to. But the angel's message wasn't complete yet. What He said to the shepherds was only part of the announcement. So let's look at the third thing. The amazement of the angels. We've seen the setting. We've seen the announcement. And now let's look at the amazement. In verses 13 to 14. And this is really where we want to hone in. As much as people are fascinated with angels, and just look on the internet and see how much people are fascinated with angels. See how many books are written on it. Angels are even more fascinated with God's salvation.
Yes, they are. Yes.
And this is what we need to emphasize this morning. It's God's salvation. This is what we're seeing here in verses 13 and 14 is God's salvation from the angels' perspective. They're not just carrying a message from God, they're giving their opinion about the message. Remember, this was their first Christmas. This has just been revealed to them. And what these angels proclaimed is really contrary to what so many churches today proclaim and teach. Nevertheless, what they said is 100% true. Verses 13 and 14 are the climax of Luke's account of the Christ's birth. And in these verses, you can sense the angels' excitement. They're ecstatic over His birth. As the first angel announces the good tidings of great joy, which he says shall be to all people. And when he says this, immediately the rest of the angels break forth in unprecedented heavenly praise. This is absolutely unprecedented. This is heaven coming down to earth.
Yes.
This is what they're doing in heaven, and for the first time we see it on earth. And I want us to see this praise as it's expressed in highly theological terms. We're not going to get more theology in a verse than what we see in verse 14. But first, let's look at verse 13. Number one, the angels praise the God of heaven. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God. And although we see this angelic announcement, glory to God in the highest, we see this phrase on secular Christmas cards, billboards, in Christmas songs, and just a host of other places. Even though the world and much of the church is clueless as to what this anthem means, these angels have summed up the truth of the ages in just these few words. Amazingly, this is the gospel of Christ in one short phrase. The anthem of praise is directly related to Christ coming into the world to save sinners. And again, it's not just an announcement from God. This is the angel's observation and understanding of what God has done for mankind through His Son. So this is the unprecedented praise to God for sending a Savior for lost sinners. But this is what we need to understand. Even though these angels are praising God for his salvation announced to all mankind, and this is where you really need to pay attention. Sorry, it's at the end of the message. But even though they're praising God for his salvation announced to all mankind, they can't comprehend it as we do. Angels are smart. They're a lot smarter than we are. But they can't comprehend salvation like we do. It's not possible for them. And I'm talking about experientially. You say, well, why can't they comprehend it experientially or sense it experientially? Well, just think about it. The godly angels never sinned, right? So they don't need a Savior. They can't really understand experientially what it means to be saved from sin. Agreed?
True.
Furthermore, fallen angels, although they have sinned, cannot understand what it means to be saved from sin because they can't ever experience God's salvation. Agreed? They can't understand like we do what salvation is. So no angel can understand or experience it.
Excuse me. Is it because they're already holy or something?
Half are holy and will never experience salvation. Well, no, I shouldn't say half, sorry. A third of the angels sinned, right?
Yeah.
So let's say part of them are holy and they can never experience salvation because they don't need it. The other part are sinful, and they can't experience it because God doesn't save angels. So, salvation is not, never has been, nor ever will be available to angels. And the Bible tells us this. We're not speculating here. Although God from eternity past always intended to save sinful men, he never intended to save any sinful angel.
Say from all the accounts of Scripture, it doesn't look like they want to be saved.
No. Well, men don't want to be saved either unless the Spirit of God turns their heart, right?
Yeah.
The Bible tells us when Jesus came into the world, he came for men, not angels. Just turn with me to Hebrews chapter 2. I'll show you this. And the context here in Hebrews 2 is Christ coming into the world for the salvation of sinners to bring them to God. Okay? Hebrews 2, verse 14. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, the children being the children of Abraham he's referring to, are human, okay? They partake of flesh and blood. Christ himself likewise shared in the same. We're flesh and blood. Jesus came in flesh and blood. That through death, he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. In other words, Jesus had to be a man to die to defeat death and the devil. He had to do that as a man, and he did. And we're not underemphasizing his deity here. We're just focusing on his humanity. And release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. That's why Jesus came, to save us from sin and bondage, so we could be with God. Look at the last part of verse 16. For indeed he does not give aid to angels. What kind of aid? Salvific aid. He's talking about salvation here. He doesn't give angels salvation. But he does give aid to the seed of Abraham.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Very clear. If Jesus was going to die for angels, he'd have to be an angel. He's not an angel. He's God, but he's man. The passage tells us the relationship of angels to God's salvation. They have none. There's no connection between angels and salvation. Personally for angels. It's not available. The seed of Abraham are Jews, and by extension here, all mankind. Everyone who has the faith of Abraham, right?
Correct.
All of mankind partakes in flesh and blood. They're human beings, just like Christ was a human being. Not to take anything away from his deity, but he is as human as those he came to save. Therefore, he's qualified to be their perfect substitute and sacrifice. One human being for another. That's why we call it substitutionary atonement. Not just one person for another, one human being for another human being. Christ became a man so he could die for men. He did not become an angel to die for angels. So the point is this. There is no connection between angels and Christ and salvation, and this is why the angels could not, never will, identify like we do with Christ and his salvation. I mean, it's if we're getting into the angels' psychology here, and they're saying, how can God save sinful men? They can't understand that. Why? Because none of their kind can be saved. How does God do this? We want to see. They can't identify. And this is one reason why the angels on that first Christmas were so ecstatic at the announcement of Christ's birth over God saving men. They wanted to and had to see how God could do this. So they're praising him in amazement that he could ever do such a thing for mankind that he never did for any angel. Peter actually talks about this. You go to 1 Peter 1. It's amazing how much is in here about this. In 1 Peter 1, in verse 10, in verses 3 to 9, Peter just described our salvation, and he blesses God for it. In verse 9, he says, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. When you're done with this life, you receive the final aspect of your salvation. That's what he just said. Look at verse 10. Of this salvation, the one he just talked about, the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that would come to you, to the church. And they were searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. Yeah, what is he talking about? He's talking about the Old Testament prophets prophesying about the coming Christ. And he's saying that there are some parts of their prophecies they didn't understand themselves, even though the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, was in them to prophesy, to write down these things. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, and all of the prophets. There were portions of their prophecies that they wrote down, but they didn't understand it. What didn't they understand? They didn't understand that in one person, you could have suffering and glory. That's what it says here. When he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. They couldn't put the two together. How could one person suffer and how could the same person be glorified? This is why when John the Baptist sent the disciples to Jesus, what was their question to him? The first question they asked.
Are you he or should we look for another?
Exactly. Are you the coming Messiah or do we look for another one? Why did they say that?
Doubt.
Because it was a common belief at that time because of these Old Testament prophecies that you had suffering and glory. A lot of Jews believed there were two Messiahs coming. One to suffer and one to die. They couldn't figure out how you could do it in one person. That's exactly what the prophets struggled with in the Old Testament when they wrote their own writings. But look, verse 12. to them, the Old Testament prophets, it was revealed that not to themselves but to us they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you. They didn't understand it, but guess what? When they prophesied, it wasn't just for Israel, it was for us too. So we could understand it. And we understand things that they didn't. That's why Jesus told his disciples. He says, blessed are your eyes for your eyes see, and your ears for your ears hear. Because many righteous men in the past desired to see what you see, and they couldn't see it. And look what he says. Which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. What? Things which angels desire to look into. It's the same theme. They don't get the gospel because they can't experience it. And yet they praise God for it. Well, the angels are still learning, albeit intellectually, how God can and will save sinful men. You know, we take it for granted. But there are creatures in the heavens that don't understand what we do. That's an amazing thing. Jesus is here, and the angels are still learning. So at the birth of Christ, although they are amazed, the angels are wondering more than ever. If God never saved any sinful angel, how can he save sinful men? If God is God and he is absolutely holy, how can he reconcile sinners to himself who are completely abhorrent to him and his nature? That's a head scratcher for an angel. How can men sin just as many angels did, and yet be set free from infinite divine punishment, which all sin deserves, which no sinful angel can ever escape? When many angels sinned, God never made a way for them to be redeemed like he did sinful men. And this is why angels earnestly desire to look into our salvation. 1 Timothy 5 says the same thing at the end of the chapter. The angels are overseeing. They are looking on the worship service of God's churches because they're trying to understand these things. So in large part, this is why these Christmas angels are praising God in the highest. They're praising God in the highest place, his abode in heaven. And they're praising God in the highest possible way, giving him glory. That is, they are magnifying and praising his perfect divine nature and attributes. They're praising him for what he has done for men because of his infinite wisdom and salvation. You know what? Not only can a man not come up with the plan of God of salvation, no man could ever come up with this plan. No angel can either. They're praising him for what he's done. How has justice and mercy come together beautifully and harmoniously in Christ? That is a mind-boggling concept. You know, the psalmist says that mercy and peace have kissed each other. And so have mercy and justice. How do you bring those two together? There's only one way. Put Jesus on a cross. That's the only way you can do it. Because of his infinite love in sacrificing his only son to save not only sinners, but to save his enemies. And we're told that we are his enemies multiple times in Scripture. Because these holy angels know God intimately, because they stand continually in His presence, and because they themselves will never know what it is to fall into sin and then be saved from it by divine grace, because of these things, they give ecstatic praise to God for what He has done through His Son. And that's what we're seeing here in Luke chapter 2. On that dark, cold winter night, when they came to those shepherds. And this is their perspective on God's incomprehensible salvation. But one more, quickly. Number two, the angels pronounce peace and goodwill to men. Verse 14. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And this is what the world misses, and sadly so do many in the church. By sending His only Son into this dark world, God offers peace and goodwill to men. That's the point of Jesus coming into the world. The phrase here, goodwill, is not in the best translations. And if you have a New American Standard or an ESV, you can see that that is not the translation. The NAS, the ESV, and the RSV have completely missed the theological intention of the phrase, and they translate it incorrectly. If you don't have a New American Standard or an ESV, this is how they read: peace among men, or peace among those with whom God is pleased. Excuse me? When has God ever been pleased with a sinner? Never. An unredeemed sinner, God is not pleased with. He's not pleased with rebellious men. He's furious with sinners.
There's only one that He is pleased with. His beloved Son.
No, I said sinners.
I know. I said there's only one that He was pleased with.
Oh, on the cross. Yeah. Yes. Thank you. God is not pleased with any unsaved person. Just the opposite is true. Yodikia. It means good pleasure or favor. But the word doesn't apply to God. It applies to sinners. The phrase should read, peace among men on whom His favor rests. And if you have a New King James or a King James or an NIV, that's how they translate it. And that's the correct theological translation. In other words, men will experience God's favor on them because of the Christ child coming into the world to save sinners. This is God's favor explicitly for the salvation offered to all mankind. For the first time in history, it is announced from heaven that all of mankind can have peace with God. Now, it's important to know here that this peace that God offers is objective peace. The Bible talks about two kinds of peace: subjective peace and objective peace. We're not talking about the peace that Jose brought to us in John 16, where Jesus says, I'm leaving my peace with you, or peace be with you. That's a subjective peace. That is a peace inside when everything around us is falling apart, right? That's the peace of Philippians 4, where it says the peace of God passes all understanding. That's subjective peace. This is not subjective peace. When He says, on earth, peace, goodwill toward men, He is talking about objective peace. You say, what is that? Well, that's peace between two warring parties. Two nations at war. When the arms are laid down, you have peace. That's the kind of peace He's talking about.
Is that good and evil? Is that good and evil?
The first peace relates to us when we pray, right? When we're not anxious for anything, but we pray to God, and He gives us peace in our hearts. That's the subjective peace. The objective peace is, before I was saved, God was at war with me. And there's a multitude of scriptures that tell us that. And when I come to Christ, the war is over. Right? And now we're no longer enemies. We're what?
Friends.
We're sons. We're not even friends anymore. We're not even friends. We're sons. He adopts enemies into his family. That's the peace he's talking about here. Let me just give you a few verses. Romans 5:1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace we never had before. That's not the feel-good peace. That's the enemies have reconciled peace. Romans 10:15. How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace. We are telling sinners that God is at war with them, but they can have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians 6:15. We're called to shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Colossians 1:10. Where Christ made peace through the blood of his cross. What did he do? He brought enemies together. He brought Jews and Gentiles together. He made peace between two warring factions. That's what the cross does. And that's just an illustration of the peace that we now have with God that we never had before. So this peace announced by the angels is a post-war peace. Most people don't recognize that men are enemies of God and that God is enraged in an unrelenting war with them. You say, well, before I was saved, I didn't feel any war against God. That's not the point. God was at war with you. You don't have to feel it. Doesn't it say the wrath of God abides on every unbeliever who doesn't have Christ? Like a furious king, God is incensed with his most ardent enemies. He's not neutral. He's not cordial toward unsaved men. He's just the opposite. He is intensely angry with unsaved people. And we need to understand this if we're going to correctly preach the gospel. The scriptures are replete with this. God is not friends with the world. And the world is not friends with God. James 4 makes that perfectly clear. Deuteronomy says, this goes all the way back to Moses. Deuteronomy 32, 41, and 42. This is God speaking. If I whet my glittering sword and my hand takes hold on judgment, I will render vengeance to my enemies and repay those who hate me. I will make my arrows drunk with blood, and my sword shall devour flesh with the blood of the slain and the captives from the heads of the leaders of the enemy. Psalm 5, 4 and 6. For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness, nor shall evil dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand in your sight. You hate all workers of iniquity. You shall destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord abhors the bloodthirsty and deceitful man. I've got a whole list here. I'm not going to read them. Psalm 50, verse 22, John 3:36, I just mentioned it. Romans 2:8 and 9 says that to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, that God will render indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil. Hebrews 10:31 says the same thing. And even though, sadly, we don't see this clearly, the angels see it crystal clearly, and that's why they made the announcement. Peace on earth. They know that God has been offended by rebellious sinners and he will have his vengeance. They know that God will pour out his wrath on sin. His fury will not be dissuaded. They know that God hates sin and is furious with sinners. And this is what they can't understand. How does he offer peace? It's the world that should be begging God for peace, and it's God who extends peace to a rebellious world. It's amazing. Angels also know that what he has done and will do to all the angels that sinned, they understand their fate. And in the same way, they know that God will destroy every sinful human being who will not submit to his Son in this world. But when God did send his son with the intention of saving sinful men, men he's at war with, men he has vowed to destroy, the angels that night looked into this salvation with wonder and said, how can God do that? How can he save these men? So when God sends the angels to earth to announce his salvation to men, to these humble shepherds outside Bethlehem, these angels are beside themselves with excitement over what God is about to do for mankind through Christ. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. So what's the message of Christmas? The angels knew.
He has arrived.
Is it feasting? Is it vacations? Is it Christmas presents? Peace.
Some fat man in a red suit?
It's glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. If you ask an angel, if you can even stand in the sight of one and ask him, that's what he's going to tell you. The Bible says it's God's gift to mankind, God's gift that for the first time, peace is available on earth to all men. And if any sinner repents and embraces Christ, if any believe that Christ died on a cross, received all of God's wrath that sinners deserve, and believes that God raised him from the dead 3 days later, God will remove his wrath from that person and proclaim peace to him or her and save him or her from his coming wrath. And then he will welcome that person into his everlasting arms. What a contrast. What a contrast. You know, I think, and I'm as guilty as anybody, I don't think we put enough contrast in the gospel. I don't think we paint nearly as bad a picture as we need to paint. Because if you don't see the darkness of your sin, you can't see the gloriousness of Christ. You know, it's the illustration of the diamond against the black velvet. You know, if we're just putting white on white, what are people going, yeah, it's just vanilla. We don't want vanilla. We want black and white. This is what Christmas is about. Peace on earth, God's favor on mankind, through that divine peace given to us in Christ because of his once for all sacrifice. Father, thank you for this time. Again, I thank you for the patience of my brothers and sisters and their love for Christ. And I pray that you would empower all of us, Lord, when you bring opportunities into our lives, that we would not hide our light under a bushel, but we would take the light and shine it in the dark places and paint the contrast that the scripture paints. Lord, help us to go into that dark world where men love darkness rather than light and bring the light, and pray that those people would come and have their deeds exposed by the light and come to Christ. We thank you, Lord, if there's anyone here who's never trusted in Christ, we pray that they would happen. Lord, they've heard the gospel, they know what it is. And I pray the Spirit of God would bring them into the kingdom. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.